Blackstone Audio presents The Vagabond Virgins by Ken Kuhlken. This one is for Zoe Ada Fox Kuhlken. Thanks to Pam Fox, Jean Reel, and Dave Knopp for help and encouragement. To Barbara Peters for excellence in editing and for creating a place where the Hickeys can live. To Father Dean McFalls for inspiration. To Steve, Bev, Sam, and Alvaro Havens, and to a shoeshine boy from Mazatlan, wherever you are. Chapter 1. Alvaro Hickey liked old movies and books about tough guys from the 30s and 40s, Pops era. They were one reason he brought his work from the penthouse suite of his employers to the fourth floor office on Broadway, with its weathered paint, coffee stains, and boxes of his brother's manuscripts stacked against a wall. In that dreary room, he could break from his desk work and imagine scenes like the long-legged blonde standing in the doorway, or like the phone call he would get today. The placard on the door read Hickey and Sons Investigations. The white paint on the plaster walls had yellowed long ago. The wooden floor creaked. Venetian blinds shaded the small window that overlooked Broadway and the city bus turnaround in Horton Plaza, a favorite hangout for the folks Alvaro grew up calling bums and winos. But this was 1979, and such names had gone out of fashion, like the term wetback, which Alvaro remembered too well. The only light came from a lamp on the ancient desk. Photos on the walls were of old Tijuana's Agua Caliente Casino, Lane Field, where the Pacific Coast League Padres had played, and the tent city on Mission Beach during World War II. Alvaro had given up squinting at the scribbled applications for green cards, visas, and citizenship, which Garfield, Robles, Patterson, Finney, and Torres, LLD, paid him to translate and polish. He was checking his watch to decide whether he needed to run for the ferry. Then the phone rang.
"Mr. Hickey?" the caller said.
He would have bet nobody could sound so gentle. Yet she spoke with confidence, and her diction was precise. He barely detected a Spanish accent with the hint of another language he couldn't make out. "Speaking."
"An attorney in Tijuana believes Tom Hickey and Sons can help me?"
Hickey and Sons was only a name on a door. Alvaro hadn't worked as a PI in 3 years since he started law school. "Which attorney?"
"Señor Agustín Cortijo."
"Okay," Alvaro said. If Augie Cortijo even talked to the lady, she either looked as good as she sounded, or she was part of the Mexican oligarchy Augie took pleasure in fleecing. "Your name is?"
"Lourdes."
She paused.
"Garcia."
Even an angelic voice can lie, he thought, then cautioned himself against judging hastily. The pause could have meant a fly landed on her, or somebody might have stepped on her foot.
"Can I come to your office?"
she asked. "Where are you?"
"I am at the Greyhound Bus Depot Señor Cortijo tells me is very close to your office."
"Wait out front," he said. "I'll be there in 5 minutes."
"I can find my way to you."
Admirable, he thought. No need. I'm due for a break and a stretch. In truth, he didn't like the idea of any woman, especially one as young and lovely as she sounded, walking the downtown streets in twilight.
"I am wearing a green hat," she said.
The Greyhound Depot was a few blocks south, at the corner of First Street and Broadway. He loped down the four flights of stairs. On the sidewalk, he walked at twice the speed of his usual amble. In cotton slacks and a sport coat over a polo shirt, which Garfield et al. Allowed as long as he buttoned it to the top, he got more than his share of stares. People, especially women, admired his wavy black hair and casual grace. He stopped for the light at First Street and spotted the woman in the green hat. She was under a street lamp near the side entrance to the depot, standing only a couple arms length.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.